confused. So the first Lowell Thomas dinner, and Lowell Thomas, a great storyteller, Lawrence of Arabia, I thought, let's do a dinner on the great storytellers, you know, and that was the topic. And so ironically, one of the people I had seen, you know, in my previous years at the Explorers Club was our speaker tonight, Chris Rainier. And so I feel, Chris, we are coming kind of full circle on the stories, but you know, I don't, maybe not too much full on the circle, because I think we both still have a lot of stories to tell. So, you know, one of the things I like to say that it sort of comes off script is, what do you know people best from? You know, something that you can't really read. Well, you can read that he was the last assistant for Ansel Adams. And that's really a throwback, because you think that every decade just brings sort of a last generation of. And I think in the world of photography, which Chris is so well known for, you know, the great sort of people who followed in the footsteps of Ansel Adams, you know, you're sort of getting lost in the sort of point and shoot era that, you know, people don't sit there. I mean, that was Photoshop before there was even Photoshop for people. Most people know Chris as a National Geographic explorer. He's documented so many indigenous cultures. And I think that in today's world, with all the tribalism that we're seeing politically around the world, that sort of letting each other know really how the other person is, the person who's on the other side of that river or border, is so important. And so that's why, Chris, I think your story never gets old, because I think that the cultural story of how people can include other people, we find that we're so much more alike than different, is so important. And so I just want to get one more fact out on you, because it's what you are doing. Today, Chris is the director of the Cultural Sanctuaries Foundation. It's a global program focused on preserving biodiversity and traditional cultural knowledge. And I'd like everybody to give a warm 2023 applause to Chris Rainier, one of the great storytellers.
Thank you so much. I'm just gonna put my timer on, so you know this is a 4-hour lecture, so. Okay. Wow, it's a great honor again to be here. So many familiar faces, friends, and specific people in the audience. You know, you come to the Explorers Club and you're surrounded by history. I don't know if you know, but some of these wonderful Explorer Club flags, one went to the moon, another went to the South Pole, another went to Everest. So you're sitting in hallowed ground. So I feel deeply honored to be here and with Richard and everybody. Before I start, I actually want to talk about a young man. He's in the audience, and I've had the great opportunity with him to travel to the Galapagos, to Iceland. We were there in June, wonderful places around the world. And he inspires me. And he is my son, Skyler, sitting here, who indeed is a remarkable young man who's going to carry on the exploration of the world. But he's a damn good drone driver, too. So, so it was interesting. This morning I woke up and I thought, you know what? I'm curious about a few things. So I want to talk a few facts before I get started. When I was born in the late 50s, the population of the world was 3 billion. Now it is almost 3 times that, 8 billion and picking up. Every day, about 200 species die, go extinct. Every 2 weeks, a traditional language, and about 80% of the world's languages are oral. A traditional elder passes away, and with them goes this huge knowledge base, every 2 weeks. By 2040, somewhere around 70% of the world's population will live in urban areas. The amount of photographs, a little tidbit here, uploaded every day onto the web, 3 billion and counting. More photographs are taken in the last 24 hours than the entire history of photography up to about 4 years ago when it was invented in 1839. Amazing facts. So the planet is under duress. But tonight, I'm going to pull up a magic carpet, and I want you to come with me around the world for about an hour. And if we could have the lights down. And you know, what is remarkable is this is the planet. And what is remarkable is there are still sacred places hidden in the deep forests over the next sand dune in the Sahara Desert. And those are the places I would like to take you tonight. I've had the great fortune of working with National Geographic for over 25 years, but it began even before that. My father was born in South Africa. My grandfather was an explorer at age 17. In about 1910, he threw an elephant rifle over his shoulder and at 17 years old, walked the length of Africa. So I grew up with these remarkable, remarkable stories. But where my photographic journey began was in the Southwest Desert of the United States. I'm Canadian, but I've spent a lot of time living in the United States. As Richard mentioned, I had the great fortune of working for Ansel Adams in the late 1980s. So in between being in the dark room and helping him print Moonrise or Clearing Winter Storm, I would take a dash out into the Southwest Desert. And what I found in this remarkable landscape, and I guess, and of course the Southwest Desert is Utah, Arizona, Colorado, New Mexico, the Four Corners area, is an ancient land with petroglyphs and ancient drawings. And I began to fall in love with the concept of cultures from our past and what do they leave behind and what is considered sacred to cultures around the world. So it really began me on a journey that culminated with the book Sacred. What is sacred? What is sacred to you? What is sacred to a Muslim? What is sacred to an atheist? What is sacred to a Native American? What is sacred to indigenous cultures around the world? And in that journey, I discovered many, many different answers. So these are images from the Southwest Desert. And what's remarkable is I saw, especially this motif, repeated over and over again around the world. It's as if this is the first selfie Instagram, if you will. Ochre against a wall. Another way of looking at it is there's a mysterious other presence of culture on the other side of the rock, as if you could put your hand up and journey into the past. I saw this repeated in the outback of Australia, etched on rocks in North Africa in the middle of the Sahara Desert. So I also began to kind of play with the idea of we are all connected. We're all connected back in ancient times, and today we're connected again. Science has now proven we're all brothers and sisters. We came from Africa, and we journeyed out from Africa some 100,000 years ago. And I think what's always remarkable for me as I journey around the world, I'm paid to photograph the differences, exotic costumes and exotic locations. But as I get older and older, I realize we have more in common than our differences. And that has been a powerful thing for me to discover. So in the process of doing the sacred book, I wandered around the Southwest Desert for several months, just going up canyons, finding old geological survey photographs of the rock art, and just remarkable. What I also found was amazing landscape. This is Beastie Badlands in northern New Mexico. You hike in, and it's if it's a alien landscape. Soon after leaving the Ansel Adams studio in 1984, I hit the road. I haven't gotten off it yet, and I'm addicted, as some of my family know. And one of the first places I went to was Varanasi, the city of light, the oldest city in India. For a Hindu, to die in Varanasi naturally is to be ensured of the ultimate transformation into enlightenment, ending the cycle of karma. Each morning, people come down to the Ganges, a river that flows from the high Himalayas, to pray and bathe in the early bright white light of Varanasi. Varanasi is home to Lord Brahma, the creator, Lord Shiva, the destroyer of the two most powerful Hindu gods. The struggle between these two forces is a struggle of good and bad, light and dark, divinity to Dante's Inferno. Here you will find the Lord of the Untouchables, the keeper of the burning guts, and the spirit being that holds the key to a person's reincarnation. Early on, I spent close to 6 weeks, 2 months living in Varanasi. If you've ever been there, it's a remarkable place. You go down to the ghats in the morning, literally millions of people come down and bathe and become sort of rejuvenated. For a Hindu, as I mentioned, to die in Varanasi is to be liberated from that endless cycle of reincarnation. And with his morning offerings to the river Ganges, a Hindu man can be assured that his life is in karmic balance. Traveling north of Varanasi, you arrive in the high country of Tibet, where here in the great peaks of the Himalayas, the driving winds and the absence of water leaves life clinging to the landscape. Here you step to the edge, and life has no room for extravagance. Here in the absence of life and the void created by nature, forces you to examine a spiritual dimension that we in the West sometimes lose in our trips to the store and the bathroom mirror. Here in Tibet, dreams of material possession and accomplishment are tinged with dark futility. After a series of trips to the Himalayas, once again after having left the Ansel Adams studio, I decided to slow down and really immerse myself in the culture. And I asked a Rinpoche, a Buddhist priest, if I could live in a monastery for about 3 months. And I did. And the intention was to go beyond the cliches. Often we have very stereotyped visions of different parts of the world. And I wanted to peel like an onion, just keep away, peeling away the layers and get to the essence and the truth of what I was seeing. Along the way, I fell in love with Buddhism. And even today, not so much as a religion, but more as a spiritual path, as a philosophy I carry on as a Buddhist. The great photographic poet, if you will, Minor White, once said, "Slow down until the object of your attention affirms your presence, and then it's time to photograph." And that's really what I did. I waited, and I waited for the photograph to come to me. And so that was a remarkable, remarkable experience. And also what I love about travel, and I really consider my camera a passport to continue to learn, is that it teaches you things. And, you know, this is an unusual image. It's a very charged image for obvious reasons. But actually, the word in Hindu and Buddhism for that symbol is swastika. It is the most sacred symbol, not only for Buddhists, Hindus, but many indigenous cultures around the world. Again, patterns and symbols that are repeated around the world, unconnected to each other. That is the circle of life. That is the most sacred symbol. Those four dots in that symbol are earth, wind, fire, sky, the elements that make up life. So again, travel and photography allows me to learn more, reserve judgment, and really listen, because I think we live in a culture where we're very ethnocentric. We see the world through our eyes. And I think when you travel, as many of you have, there is a different reality. There's a different way of being out there that is very different than being North American or from the United States. So again, spending 3 or 4 months there, I also have repeatedly gone back. One of my favorite places to go is Bhutan. And if you ever have the chance to go there, it is one of those countries that you literally step back in time. And the king of Bhutan came up with a wonderful slogan, gross national happiness. So when you're in Bhutan as a studying Buddhist, your goal, even in the middle of a transaction, is not to get the best deal for yourself, but to ensure the other person has a better deal. So you imagine that shift in our culture, if we shifted to the perspective that my mission with any exchange is to make the other person more happy than I am. Interesting concept. So obviously during COVID, many of these countries have been shut down. Just got word, we've all been listening and hearing about China. Tibet is going to open up in May, and so I've been trying to get into one of the holiest mountains in the world, is Mount Kailash. And this is where Tibetan, Hindu, many pilgrims will come to this mountain, which they consider the source of all life, and many of the great rivers that flow down into India and into China come from Kailash. And at any one time, there's 1,000 pilgrims totally prostrating and moving around this mountain. So there are still places to explore. This is a Maniwal in Ladakh, and that is a part of India, but it's up on the Tibetan plateau. And what's remarkable about this, and you see these Maniwals scattered across the Tibetan plateau, each and every one of those rocks are etched with the Tibetan chant, Om Mani Padme Hum, which loosely translates to, O Buddha, give me eternal life. Give me the chance to come back and get it better next time. Very much like Hindus in Varanasi. Sliding off the Himalayas, you drop down into Cambodia, specifically Angkor Wat, which is a remarkable, wonderful place. Asia is of two worlds. One world is the slow ticking of time in the tropical forest, where the mind moves reluctantly and spirits hold their own ancient forms. And here, amongst the misty, musty decay of monuments to Buddha, nature takes a stance and reclaims all that man has made. I had the great fortune of getting to Angkor Wat before all of the tourists did. I was a war photographer for many years for Time magazine, and back in 1990, just at the tail end of the Khmer Rouge War, the battles were still going on, I had a chance to go and do a story in Cambodia, and I made a special detour and went into Angkor. And of course, you could still hear the mortar fire off in the distance, and it was an amazing place to go. If you have the opportunity to go there, it is incredible. And I met this amazing monk. He was the sole survivor of a monastery right beside a particular temple there. And at that time, I was doing a project on traditional tribal tattooing around the world, and he had these remarkable, remarkable tattoos. And I was very respectful of him. He was very daunting, so I photographed him, flew home, turned on, went to a movie theater, and there was Anjolie, Laura Crofton, and who was the main actor but him? I didn't have to be reverent to him. And if you ever have a chance to go to Cambodia, and certainly Angkor Wat, post-COVID has got reasonable amounts of people. Pre-COVID, there are thousands of people there. But get off the beaten track. This is an area about 2 days out of Angkor Wat. This amazing, amazing temple. You know, it's as if you could watch those roots just growing in front of your eyes. Those are the places. So it's like going to Venice. Turn left, get off the beaten track, go 3 or 4 blocks in, and there's no tourists. So many places in the world are really in the point where they're beginning to get overrun, but there's so many other places. You'll never find them on TripAdvisor, and please don't post them in your Instagram, that you can go to, that you'll sit there, and you'll be the only person there. And again, Angkor Wat is probably about 13 square miles, an incredible place just to wander around, and also a part of Asia, Southeast Asia, is Burma. And I had a chance to go to Myanmar, Burma, I preferred to call it, just before this whole debacle, of course, that's unfolding in Myanmar now, and these stunning, stunning monuments. For me, photography is about the light. And obviously, I had a wonderful mentor, Ansel, that many critics talked about even more than him being a landscape photographer. He was a light photographer. I had the great privilege when I worked for him to proof, to make prints of all 60,000 of his negatives. That took me about 6 years, 7 years. Decided to start with his very first negative. And what my trail was understanding the process of an artist. And what I really, really discovered was he was in search of light. He had to have the perfect light. He would often go to places, scout out, decide the light wasn't good, come back, and it would take him years and years and years. I remember him coming out of the darkroom once with a print, and he said, "That's finally the print I've been trying for all these years." Went over and looked at the negative, and it was from 1923. And that was in 1982 that he finally got it. This young monk in Burma followed me around in Pagan, and he was just curious, very intense eyes. And we discovered in this cave this beautiful reclining Buddha, and he just stepped up and he was watching me, turned around, took one image, and then he disappeared. There are these moments that you seize and then they drift away. Australia. So I spent close to 10 years of my youth in Australia. And my father had a job that he would often go out into the outback and sit on oil rigs. And as a young man, I would, during the summer vacations, go and fell in love with Aborigine culture and understanding that this remarkable culture is one of the oldest religions, if you will, in the world. This rock art dates back 50,000 years. Wow. And so you tucked back in these dry canyons. I mean, aliens? Do we believe in aliens? Look at that. And these are 50,000 years old. And I fell in love with the concept of dream time, the dream time spiritualism, religion, if you will. And it's very layered and very complicated. But what I've garnished from talking to many Aborigine elders over the years, their concept of the song lines as well as time. Time is actually the past, the present, and the future combined. It's fascinating. We're living in this era where traditional culture meets with scientists that are developing the string theory. And so there's a lot of overlap. So, you know, the indigenous cultures has some knowledge way beyond modern science. Modern science is only 300 to 400 years old. Traditional knowledge is 10,000 generations of empirical evidence of tried and true methodology. So when I sit down with an Aborigine elder, again, reserve judgment for me and understand a different way of looking at the world. I love this one. It's almost as if there's a dance with the tree over there. So when I was living in Australia, I had heard about this mythical land to the north, New Guinea, the island of New Guinea, a Stone Age culture. And so as a young boy, I had dreamed of going there. And eventually, I got there on assignment in about 1992. Fell in love with a place where masks still dance, where there's mythology around life and death and birth and war. And I ended up moving there to New Guinea for about 10 years, using it as a base, going in and out on different assignments, but I systematically wanted to document the entire Stone Age tribes that were remaining in New Guinea. And eventually did that and published a book, Where Masks Still Dance, New Guinea. And about halfway through the trip, I had heard where this young man was going to be initiated. And of course, it's a culture very much where you're initiated from childhood into adulthood, adulthood into warrior status. And so I had heard about this young man who was going to be initiated. So I hiked many valleys to this particular valley. New Guinea is so rugged and so isolated that literally you don't go from one valley to the next. It has 1,000 languages, not dialects, 1,000 languages. So literally, very few people go to the next valley or certainly the next valley over. So again, I had hiked in the day before this image was taken. I had come over the mountain, down the ridge, coming up, and just to the camera right of where we are, there was an old man sitting there watching me huff and puff coming up the hill. And when I sat down through my translator, he said, "Which valley are you from?" And I smiled and I said, "Oh, many, many valleys away." And I was white, so quite conceivably, the folks over in the next valley could have been white. He would have never known. So he kept persisting, "No, which valley are you from?" And I said, no, way, way. And then he looked up at the sky and he smiled and again through the translator said, "You're from where the green meets the blue." He had heard of this place where the mountains ran out, and of course it was the ocean. And I thought, what a beautiful, beautiful metaphor. And I wrote that down in my journal. And about 10 years ago, I was at a conference and had a chance to lecture and talk about where the green meets the blue. And soon after, an astronaut, the last female astronaut that had been up in the space station, did her lecture. And then she ran over to me and she said, I know what you're talking about. I used to sit up in the space station. And I'd look at Earth, and I'd look out into space, into absolutely the void, and look back where the green meets the blue. We have this one precious island that we need to preserve. That was a big takeaway. Okay, skipping along on our magic carpet, hitting the South American continent, Machu Picchu. A remarkable culture, great privilege. When I was working with National Geographic, I co-partnered with Wade Davis, who has lectured here many times, a remarkable author, and we did a series of documentaries around the world called Light at the Edge. And we went and dove deeply into the Inca culture. And this is a very powerful place. The Incas understood the alignment of light and seasons. This was a sundial, so when there was a crack up in the mountains about 3-4 miles away, and only when the light, and it only came through once a year, passed through this kind of crack between two mountains and hit the sundial, was it time to plant your crops. Deep understanding. Another place in Peru, the Nazca lines, the Nazca culture, some 600 to 700 years ago. Amazing art, these trapezoids, these incredible different animal motifs, etched often miles and miles in length. That's probably half a mile long. I'm up in a helicopter photographing it. And they never got to see what they created. Isn't that amazing? Absolutely amazing. And this is another variation. So you see monkeys, you see hummingbirds, you see all these different structures. So another place, Iceland. And I had the great wonder, as I mentioned, that Skylar and I went there in June, and he took two drones, and we had an absolute blast driving around and creating an amazing video of his. And I've been there a number of times. And I find Iceland to be as if the day after creation. It's just brewing with this power and this energy and this rawness. And had a chance to go there during COVID, got special permission because there was a volcano that went off. And so I'll show you a photograph in a second here, but there's a particular beach called the Diamond Beach. And so there's a glacier, and the glacier calves, the icebergs come out at low tide, they're sucked out into ocean, they tumble around in the salt water, at high tide they're brought up. And the ironic thing is I'm out there with my tripod and my 35 millimeter camera, first wave comes along with a little series of small icebergs, I'm knocked over and almost destroyed my camera. I said, to the heck with that. And I took my iPhone out. That is taken on an iPhone. So long live iPhones. And this is Black Lava Beach. And I love dancing back and forth in between black and white and color. I'm just getting the sense of the psychology of color and getting comfortable with it after 30 years. But I still love black and white. And the volcano. And of course, during what was that, 2019, 2020, this amazing volcano went off, and I had the chance to go there two or three times. And this is on the last trip. I was there. It was about 3 a.m, and I sat down, photographed this incredible eruption that would happen precisely every 12 minutes. And I sat down and I thought, again, at the beginning of time, the beginning of the island, and I thought, wow, what is sacred? What is sacred in our lives? And it really, I pondered on it for a very long time. No one else was up there, and then I looked around the corner, and there were a couple of photographers, and I kind of went, oh my God, that's Franz Lanting, another National Geographic photographer. And then 200 feet beyond, there's Jim Balog, another National. So it, we all kind of ended up at the same spot, not even knowing that we were going to be there. So carrying on from Iceland, you hit Scotland, one of the islands off the northern part of Scotland, the Callendish Stones, back into the Druid time. This is 2,000 years before Christ, somewhere in that area. Of course, these are the motifs that we know well from Stonehenge. This shot is probably midnight, very slow shutter speed, so you get the movement of the clouds. But all of a sudden, this Druid-like woman with black witch outfit stepped into the photograph. And so she's sort of drifting somewhere in my image. So I kept trying to get her out and she ignored me. So I took a portrait at the Callendish Stones. And these, of course, are scattered all over Wales, Scotland, England, into Brittany. This actually was a burial site. So when it was first discovered, what they did was they set up the rocks and then they built up dirt, pushed that horizontal rock up there, and in between those rocks, that section is the burial mound. And they're still discovering those in different parts of England and Scotland. Very, very powerful. And talk about repetition of motif, there is a very similar place in very isolated islands in Indonesia. And there are also smaller versions of this out in the middle of the Sahara Desert. And again, that idea of kind of mystery that I wanted to do the blurred clouds. So, Africa. My father is South African. I have a great love of South Africa. And so I got a wonderful assignment years ago from Smithsonian to photograph some of the archaeological ruins and the culture that lived along the Nile. And what I love is going to places that are PowerPoints. Easter Island, the Taj Mahal, Machu Picchu, but I like going on a full moon and actually photographing it in the moonlight. So I got permission to spend the night on the farthest pyramid, and I spent the full night up on the top of the pyramid photographing the moonlight. And Abu Simbel, which is in the southern part of Egypt. This was actually the archaeological site that got moved by UNESCO back in the 60s because they built a big dam. But Abu Simbel is a powerful, powerful place. And it's the burial site of Ramsay twice a year on the spring and fall solstice. The sun will come up to the west and a beam of light goes all the way down and hits his burial site. So Egypt is incredible. If you fly over Egypt, it is basically a desert except for the Nile, which has about 5 to 8 miles of greenery on each side. So they are still discovering sites. There's a explorer at National Geographic, Sarah Payak, and she is a space archaeologist. So she is using LIDAR taken from satellites, and she finds archaeological sites. She has found 40 new archaeological sites in Egypt that the Egyptian government knew nothing about. She's now working on a project and discovering that the Vikings actually made it down potentially as far as Florida. So what she's doing, again, is taking the satellite pictures, crowdsourcing. People go on Google image and Google satellite imagery, and then find areas that look kind of like an anomaly. She'll buy the LIDAR plates, and she's discovering things almost on a monthly basis. Now, if you go out to the pyramids and wait long enough, you'll see the Bedouins that come out of the Sahara Desert, as far away from Chad and Western Egypt. And they'll get off their camels and they'll pray to this incredible monument. I fell in love with the concept of going into the desert, deep into the desert. So way back in the late 1990s, I put together an expedition, and we were in Timbuktu. We headed out of Timbuktu, and 14 days by camelback into the Sahara Desert is this ancient salt mine where there's still black African slaves working away. This is a mine that has been worked since the 12th century. If you flash back to the 12th century, the culture in the middle of the Sahara Desert, the University of Timbuktu had 30,000 students and scholars from as far away as Cairo and Baghdad would journey to Timbuktu. And we had the great privilege of discovering these books that were 600 to 700 years old with beautiful gold calligraphy, stories about astronomy and law and medicine. Meanwhile, we were still in the Middle Ages up in Europe. So there's some incredible, beautiful archives of Islamic culture that still exist in Timbuktu. As we're heading north, my guide kept saying, you know, we're looking for the eye of the needle. And I said, what do you mean by the eye of the needle? And he said, come, I'll tell you about the eye of the needle. Come to discover that all of the sand dunes in this area go east-west, and the only place to take the camels were through this little slot called the eye of the needle. We come into these little oases, and these men dressed in their blue Tuareg costumes, these were bandits, often taking stolen cars that would be brought over from Italy into Tunisia and drive them through the Sahara Desert late at night and sell the Mercedes, stolen BMWs down in the black part of Africa, the Congo, Cameroons, Ghana, places like that. Very edgy. If you linger long enough in these oases, you'll see the men gathering in front of the mosques, and they'll step inside and pray. These incredible kind of adobe mud mosques. These mysterious sticks are actually every spring after the rains, they have to re-plaster the adobe. So they put these wooden planks on and they can crawl up the side. And then again, after the Oman has done his prayers on a Friday, you'll find men under the shaft of light at midnight reading their Quran. And you come across these remarkable monuments lost out in the desert. We would often travel and stop, see things like this, or I'd look down into the ground and there'd be a pottery shard. Wow. 12 to 13,000 years ago, the Sahara Desert was green. There were all these amazing cultures that existed. So I'd pick up these pottery shards and I realized that, you know, there's a constant wind in the Sahara. 2 days before, that was probably covered in sand, had been covered in sand for 12,000 years. If you stayed long enough, that pottery shard would have been covered in another 2 days. There are amazing archaeological discoveries to be made, but art and culture scattered throughout the Sahara Desert. You arrive at the salt mine, and as I mentioned, it's a scene out of the Bible. They're chipping this salt, and then it is taken by camelback 14 days back to Mopti on the Niger River, broken up and sold throughout West Africa. Why? Why do this in a contemporary age? Because it's these kind of traditions that have gone on since the 12th century. Fathers taking their sons out on the camel caravan, and those traditions are the fabric that keeps the tapestry of culture together. When you take that fabric out, the line of tradition, the textile, if you will, of culture begins to unravel. And you see that all around the world. You head further south into southern Mali, northern Burkina Faso, and you're in the Dogon culture, one of the few indigenous animistic cultures that withstood the onslaught of Islam as it came down through the 12th century. This is a young man. He's going through his initiation ritual. He's holding the mask in his teeth. It's not tied to his head. And so for his initiation, he goes into a trance and dances with this mask. And for the time he is dancing with the mask, he's the conduit between the spiritual world and the earthly world. And you'll wander around in the Dogon area and you'll see these old ruins, and it's very much like the Anastasi. If you've ever gone down the Grand Canyon or gone to Chaco Canyon, exactly like that. One of the projects that I worked on for a very long time was a book on traditional mask rituals, and probably the epicenter of that is in a place like Burkina Faso. This is the butterfly mask. This is the bull mask. And so when I do my books and my projects, I like to, the reoccurring theme is documenting traditional cultures, but it has to be a visual story. So I'm looking for threads. Ancient marks was traditional tattooing, masks were the sundial mask here, and this book, of course, is on sacred. And again, these incredible costumes, and many of these costumes, the shamans, the elders, wear these masks and they become the conduit to the spiritual world. Shamans are often very tortured people because they live in both realities and they're seeing the raw spiritual world out there. But they'll put the mask on and they'll become a part of another world. Jordan, Petra, I don't know if anybody's been there, but if you go down the Slot Canyon, you arrive at this building. You all know this building because that famous scene with Sean Connery and Harrison Ford, this is, you know, where they ride in and they see the amazing ruin. This is that part. This culture was linked to trading on the Saudi Arabia Peninsula. So spices and silks that didn't go along the Silk Road would be brought by boat to the edge of sort of northeast Saudi Arabia. And so there was a place in Saudi Arabia that I had wanted to go to, a place called Ala Ula. And Saudi Arabia, of course, has been closed for decades. Had the opportunity during COVID to be able to get into Saudi Arabia to the place called Ala Ula. I'll get there in a moment. This is some obviously Muslim women at Petra. And so when the Romans came through Petra, kicked out the culture there, they went further into the desert and went to Ala Ula. And again, places that I like to go on the full moon, and this was the full moon at sunrise, and you can just see the sun beginning to come, but the light that's bathing that is the full moon light. And this was at a time where Saudi Arabia was closed, got special permission to go in and go to this specific site, spent a couple of days around the full moon photographing it. Now, I'm Canadian. One of my favorite places is British Columbia. And my family has deep, deep ties to this area. And there is a place north of Vancouver Island called Haida Gwaii. And it is where the Haida culture, the epicenter of the Haida culture. And they created these remarkable totem poles. Many of the totem poles on the Queen Charlotte Islands are still there, and they were created 100 years ago. So what you see are these fantastic totem poles decaying, and trees are growing up through them as if these things were alive and transforming into a different culture. You can see this tree has grown and just cracked open the totem pole. The Haida culture is a very, very powerful culture. Up until the early 1900s, they were so wealthy from salmon oil, fur pelts from otters, that they basically were the most powerful tribe. They would take their war canoes all the way down to Seattle, some 500 or 600 miles to the south and way up into Alaska. And these totem poles are there. It's a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It's very difficult to get there. Skylar and I did a trip on a sailboat expedition, I think about 4 years ago there, and had a chance to kayak one afternoon around these amazing islands with the totem poles. Also, they have the potlatch, and you may have heard about this tradition. And this was a tradition that was strong and vibrant until the early 1900s. And like so many colonial governments, including mine, the Canadian government, they made it illegal and they confiscated and stole a lot of these traditional masks. Many of them are still housed in the American Museum of Natural History collections all over the world. And what the potlatches were all about were these gatherings between warring tribes. They would come together, and one particular tribe, in an effort to try and make peace, would give offerings. They would give a lot of salmon oil and blankets, and they would have a potlatch, these amazing dances that would go on all night long. They believe in the spirits of the ocean of forest. This is the raven, and so during the dance, this mask opens up, and there's usually another inner mask, like the alter ego of that particular dance. This is the orca. Again, these beautiful, beautiful costumes. What's remarkable, it's specifically in a place called Alert Bay, which is at the northeast corner of Vancouver Island, is that this particular Haida tribe have single-handedly taken on the Smithsonian, taken on the Natural History Museum, taken on the Royal Museum of Canada and many of the Berlin or German collections. And they're having their masks brought back and repatriated. And so they have this incredible museum in this small little village. So if you ever happen to find yourself up at the northern end of Vancouver Island, do go to this UMISTA museum. I had the great fortune during the mask book to be able to photograph their collection. And like I often do, I'm unbearably persistent. If I want something, I'll do it. So it took me 5 years to get permission. I took a trip up there, sat with the elders, showed them my other books. They kind of hemmed and hawed. And finally, I got an email, said, come on up. And for a week, I had whatever mask I wanted to photograph. I hired this young, amazing, Canadian Indian, and he's in all of these photographs. This is the sea monster, and of course they fear the ocean, so this is kind of a representation of that particular mask. And then one day I was sitting with Ryan, the gentleman, and he said, you know, my brother committed suicide last year. And I said, I'm so sorry. He said, but you know what? That makes me the chief. And we are the bear clan. And for probably about 20 years, I've wanted to photograph the bear regalia. This is one of the most sacred masks in North American native culture. And then he said, would you like to see my mask? And I was like, yeah. Would you like to photograph it? Yeah. So this is a great privilege to be able to show this image, to share it with you, and there are a number of secret ceremonies that are embedded deep in Native American cultures scattered throughout the Southwest as well as up here that I am, for the purpose of documenting, trying to get permission to be able to photograph. And I do that with great respect because they are very cautious. They have, rightly so, been very burned by many experiences. So they are hesitant. But what I am finding is the older generation are still very scarred by the experience. But the younger generation, as they realize their culture is disappearing like sand through their hands, they want to share it. So the young 20 to 30 year old different traditional tribes say, yes, come see our dances. We're so proud. We want to show you these. So there's a real revitalization that's going on around the world with traditional cultures. So as you come down off the west coast, you hit, again, the California coast. This is Big Sur, one of our favorite places to go. And this is Pfeiffer Beach, again on a full moon. This remarkable place. These sand dunes are out in Nevada, part of Death Valley. This was taken a long time ago, about 1980, and I had a golden retriever at that point named Jassy. And so I had my 4x5 camera all set up. I'm turning around to get the film, and she's like running out into the middle of, you know, paw prints, stop! So luckily I could just tweak the camera a little bit, and she just sat there. And could you imagine if I didn't notice her, she would have completely destroyed this art form. So I now live in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and literally 5 miles from my house are these pueblos, these Native American groups. And again, this is the youth. I went and saw them do a performance, and I said, would you mind if I photograph the costumes? They said, no, come. And so we kind of went back and forth, and they said, meet us at the casino on Sunday morning. And so about 5 pickup trucks pull up, and we go on to their land, where I'm not allowed to go unless I get permission. And we go out there, and as we're wandering out there, these remarkable clouds are all forming. And the dark clouds are coming in, and I'm kind of getting antsy because I know it's going to rain. And I said, okay, we got to start photographing. And they went, no, Chris, we have to do this ceremony. It takes about 20 minutes. We have to dance and allow the spirits to come in. So they start, this incredible clouds behind. I'm fidgeting. All of a sudden, I went, wait a minute. I'm out here. It's such a privilege to be here. So I clicked my still part of my camera onto video, and I have this amazing documentation of the traditional dances. I'm the only guest white person there, and I'm photographing them doing things that have gone on for thousands of generations. And that's the privilege of sometimes being a photographer, that suddenly you're there and you're witnessing it as it's happened. This is the white buffalo. It's like an albino black buffalo. So they reveal the white buffalo. This is the traditional costume. This is the deer dance. Every January, it was just a full moon 4 or 5 days ago. Every January on the full moon in the Defonso Pueblo, which is 5 miles from Santa Fe, you'll go there. You're not allowed to bring your cameras. They have a big, huge bonfire in the Pueblo area. And about 100 men are up on top of a hill, dressed as deer. You'll see the little bells down on their sticks. And they'll come down, and you can hear them chanting and the bells coming down. And they will circle the fire and dance all night long. An incredible experience that still exists in the 21st century. This is the black buffalo. And so, again, one of my long-term projects is try and document a lot of the North American traditional Native American rituals and costumes that, again, are being revived and coming back. There are powwows in the state of New York. There are powwows. During the summer, they get together and have these amazing dances. I invite you to go. So near the end of my mask project, I heard about this young man, Gene the Raven Dancer, and he has this incredible raven costume. And I said, I'd love to photograph you. Took a couple of months to put together. He's Tlingit, but he lives down in Tacoma, out on the ocean area. So I said, can you meet me about 4 p.m, and we'll kind of get to know each other and do this photography session. So he was late. Sun was beginning to fade, the clouds were coming in, I was really beginning to panic. And then he shows up, comes out in his costume, we kind of start this wonderful rapport, and he does the Raven Dance. And photographed him for 10, 15 minutes, the light faded, and then we were walking back to his car, and he says, you know, I teach a lot of Native American children about their culture. And the thing that indigenous people kind of get wrong sometimes is they're trying to decolonize their minds. You may have heard that phrase of getting rid of the past Western influence. He said, you know, they're all wrong. All of us, not just us Native people, but us white folk, if you will, we all need to re-indigenize ourselves. reconnect ourselves to the planet. And if indeed, if we're going to survive beyond the 21st century, we need to step into our ancient past in the present for the future generations to survive. So what I'd like to do, we're zooming around in the magic carpet. Just before we kind of come in and land in New York, I'd like to take you back to Angkor Wat and show you a little video. It's music. I had the great privilege of, during National Geographic, to meet Ravi Shankar and his daughter, Anushka Shankar. So we collaborated with a good friend of mine that is a videographer and created this little piece on sacred. And at that time, I was thinking a lot about what it meant to be sacred, and I had just covered a couple of conflicts around the world, so I decided to go to Cambodia and create this. So enjoy, sit back, relax. Thank you. So is our, thank you. As our magic carpet kind of lands here on the Upper East Side, it reminds me we're really at a crossroads. We're at that moment where the fate of our planet for future generations is really going to be decided in the next 20 to 30 years. The tsunami of modernity is sweeping over many of these sacred places. And to end tonight, I'd like to do a quote from the great social anthropologist Margaret Mead. She once said, having been born into a polychromatic world, her greatest fear for her grandchildren, and indeed all of our children, is that they will wake up one day in a monochromatic world and never know the difference. Thank you. No? Question.
The storyteller. You know, you talk about sacred places, and I've always considered this to be somewhat of a sacred lectern, as I've seen Jane Goodall with her hands here, and Neil Armstrong, and Buzz Aldrin, and Richard Leakey. And so that tradition of storytelling is very much alive. Now, I know we have only a few minutes for questions, because we have a book signing out there.
Sacred is out there.
Sacred is out there. It'll be more sacred with a book in your hand. I'm giving the crass pitch, but it's a fantastic book, as all his other books are. Ann Passer, who runs our Monday night lectures, thank you very much for bringing Chris in. She said that we have people watching online in Brazil, in Barcelona, all around the world. So your voice has been echoed much further than here. I'm going to start the questions off. I saw you were up in Arnhem Land. And so one of the things that always struck me there is when you talk about dream time or how people think, it's very different. And so a rock may be a rock to me, or a tree, where that's something that's living for them. So how do you communicate? Because you're obviously from a Western society, and your media is going to be viewed most likely in a Western format. So how do you bridge that gap and make that sort of authentic to their feelings?
Very good question. So there's the logistics of getting there, having a translator. We all have to do that. We have to produce. But what I find in traditional cultures is it's the silence that speaks. It's the nonverbal communication. We have lost touch with our nonverbal communication. You know, on the plains of Africa 100,000 years ago, if we didn't use our eyes, we were eaten, bitten, or fell off a cliff. So there are these incredible senses that we have that we've lost touch with. And what my greatest love is to sit down around a crackling fire at night and say nothing with an elder there. And there's a nonverbal level of deep communication that happens. When you often walk into these gatherings and you're trying to find the alpha male who's probably the spiritual leader, he's the one sitting in the back watching you. That's the kind of level of communication that I arrive and I need to really slow down and pay attention to a whole other world out there that we're disconnected from in the West.
Don't you keep wandering away. Stay here.
I want to get to the bar.
I know. Any questions from there?
Yes, please. Yes, ma'am.
Wendy?
Thank you, Louise. Chris, thank you. You really took us on a magic carpet ride that I know so many in the room really needed. How has the actuality of a pandemic affected the way you see and what you're going to do going forward? Because this is an unprecedented experience for all of us on this earth at the same time.
Very good question. And to be brutally frank, you know, many indigenous cultures have lost a lot of their elders. Down where I am in New Mexico, the pueblos are still not open, and they're still losing a tremendous amount of their elders. So there's a rapid movement around the world, very similar to what we did at National Geographic, of documenting those endangered languages before the elders go. But I think for all of us, it is remind us of how fragile it is, how important our family is, our children, and that, I think, permeates around the world. And I think what it's also done is reset how we travel. Bhutan, for example, closed down, and they were really dealing before COVID with this massive influx of tourism. It's given many countries an opportunity to reset the bar. And it's still a challenge, but to set the challenges of getting into these countries. So the King of Bhutan has decided to up the visa level. And so he wants to preserve his culture. He doesn't want it overrun by humans like Venice or places like that. So it's given pause to cultures around the world of, as we're rapidly sort of dealing with this tsunami of modernity, how do we keep authentic experiences alive?
We have an online question from Jenny Wolkowicki. I hope I'm pronouncing it right, Jenny. Do you ever get into a trance? And if so, where?
Burning Man.
Question in the front row. Louise?
So I'm still processing everything that I've just seen, but it's been pretty incredible as a journey. But what's been interesting about seeing the approach is that there's a combination of nature, humans, and then maybe society or not, right? And what struck me really interestingly, obviously, was that the connection of people, especially with the indigenous communities in Native America, like clearly, especially given that you've are from there, which was beautiful for me to watch. But then I saw the images in Varanasi, and for me it was really interesting because in my mind, I know how political that entire place is right now, and how challenging actually it's been between sacred versus right. Right? And at the same time, also thinking about what it means in terms of what we're sending as a message to the world, when we're thinking about the juxtaposition between sacred actions, nature, yes, human, devoid culture, and climate, especially when I was thinking about when I read about your thesis around the concept of sacred, yeah, right? As we're looking at, it's been interesting to see that there's always been a clear connect between humanity, justice, and climate or nature, right, in indigenous cultures, yes, which all of us kind of ignored. And hence, when you go on this journey, you're like, yeah, it's there. So how do you feel about that in terms of what we're depicting, given the current situations of most of the places that you're showcasing right now?
I love these light questions.
We have always very light. Intelligent.
Absolutely, I love it. Well, I operate on a number of levels. I'm a photojournalist, so I could very easily go to Varanasi and photograph one of the most polluted, toxic rivers in the world. But what I love about very educated, you know, people around the world, Indians included, that are Hindus, they will step into the magic of what they project and what a religious belief projects on it. And that was actually the genesis of me starting Sacred. It was in the Sahara Desert, and Muhammad, our guide, said, "Can I show you one of the most sacred places in the world?" I said, "Yes." He said, "It's going to take a day or two camel direction." And so he kept building up. You know, Muhammad had created this beautiful place. You must come see it. We came over the hill, and it was a pond, maybe 100 yards wide, of beautiful turquoise water. And he had tears in his eyes, and he said, "Allah created this. This is the most amount of water I've ever seen in my life." And it made me think, what is sacred? I would look at it and just go, well, it's probably a body of polluted water. But to him, it was Allah reincarnate. So I think we need to, and I need to, continue to respect other realities. The world is made up of a multitude of different cultures, different belief systems. And I think, I hope I answered the question, but I think we live in complex times. What I learned from Ansel Adams, his choice was not to go into Yosemite Valley and show all the tourists, and it's overrun with tourists, but the affirmation of beauty. And we, what we love, we save.
We have another online question from Roberto Sacco for Chris. What are the limitations of the medium photography in capturing the sacred?
Ooh, I love these questions. You know, one of Ansel's really good friends was Alfred Stieglitz. He was married to George O'Keefe, one of the great early 20th century photographers. He had a project called Equivalences. He would go to a place and have an emotional response to that place. His mission was to create the equivalent emotion in you, the viewer. So that is my mission when I set up my tripod or my camera, or as my son's kind of like trying to get me into the modern mirrorless cameras, something like that. I think, how can I take a photograph that you will look at and you will have the same emotional response? And it is the training, like a painter, like a sculptor, is that you, 10,000 hours type of thing, you hone your skill so you know a set of composition, color, black and white, that you know how to manipulate your audience, if you will. So I think for me, it's a kind of trying to really be clear about what I want to say, or pre-visualize the statement of what I want to do with those photographs.
You know, I was speaking to your family before the lecture, and I said, you know, with the advent of point-and-shoot cameras, iPhones, and you demonstrated that in Iceland with one of your shots, that at any point, all of us are capable of a great shot, right? We've all taken a shot, go, wow, this is pretty good. But you know, what I've noticed with the greats, and we've had many National Geographic photographers, it's just the body of work. It's just one fantastic photo after another, and the standard's so high. So I think we feel very privileged to see your work, and we're very thankful that people do value what you do more than just saying, I'm gonna get a blogger to go out there and capture a sacred place. We do have a book outside called Sacred. It's a fantastic book. I've got a chance to look through it before this. You know, if you have any inclination in really going on a deeper journey with Chris, I recommend you get in line and buy one of those. And in the meantime, thank you so much, Chris, for what you do. I think that everybody here, I think I can speak for everybody, that we're so grateful that talented people like you are sort of capturing the human experience. So for that, thank you. Don't forget your books.
So if you have any questions, I'm up here, and also the book is out there, and I'm happy to personalize it. I'll also make a note. I stepped out of the way in the writing and let some really great authors, Mathieu Ricard, a Buddhist monk that often travels with the Dalai Lama, speaks about Buddhism, Terry Tempest Williams, Pico Iyer, Wade Davis, Nainoa Thompson, this remarkable Hawaiian who's brought back the craft of wayfinding and speaks, and then Jean, the Raven Dancer, wrote in it. So it's many different ways of looking at what it means to be sacred. Thank you for coming tonight. It's a great honor.